Oh, okay. Okay, there's a lot of things he tried to do but cannot achieve. So, okay, as I was saying, scientists actually tour Malaya, if you know. He actually has a so-called museum in Penang. And that's, Malaya was one of the center, actually one of the main center that he operated the so-called campaign to overthrow the Qing dynasty. He was persecuted, of course, and you know, various assassination attempts was made against him, and you know, he has to exile, so to speak. And Malaya, Penang, is actually one of the main center. And that's why you have a lot of people in China. So some people follow him. So, but there are already significant number of Chinese already in Malaya, especially in Penang and Perak at that time. So he did something, a campaign drive, donation drive. People actually, he raised a lot of money actually. And this contributed to the political awakening of Chinese in Malaya. Okay? And okay, so very just some trivia. So it's under the Ming Dynasty that Admiral Chang He actually went on several expeditions. Chang He in our discourse is also known as
Cheng Ho.
So you know, you heard about him, right? He actually went to Malaya a few times, I think about 7 times, not just one time. And theories on how Mandarin become the national language. Okay, this is very quickly dumbed down over here again. So, you know, like just now Kang said about the Indians, we speak different languages. It's actually dialects. We have classical Chinese, which in the written form, and then it's like your the Chinese, like the Chinese. But the way it's being spoken is different. You go to the north, it's different, you go to the south, it's different. But by the 20th century, basically 1911, 1912, 1911 People Revolution, 1912 and to 1914, like that, they're trying to decide what should be the national language. It's quite clear that Mandarin should be the national language because more people speak Mandarin, and it mirrors the classical Chinese more, so to speak. But This is a legend. It's not a scholarly fact, but I just want to share with you, like, Malays have legend, Chinese also have legend. So the legend states that at a meeting to decide which one should be the national language, it was boiled down to Cantonese or Mandarin. Cantonese actually a lot of people speak it, especially in the south. The legend has it that it was boiled down to one vote, and the one vote is Dr. Sun Yat-sen's vote, and he voted for Mandarin because he is Cantonese. And he wrote Cantonese, you know, people might be shocked, people don't like it. So, you know, for national unity, he voted for Mandarin. It's you know, a good gesture, lah. But it's just a legend. Mandarin won by far more votes. Okay, second. So, you see all the Chinese speaking Mandarin now. Actually, quite interesting because we don't speak Mandarin in the past, you know. And it was mainly through education, school, so that when they adopted the national language, all schools speak Mandarin. They teach Mandarin, so that's how you get, you know, if you meet China people, if you walk out of this door, I'm sure you'll see one. Okay, so moving on to the more modern times. Like I said, to the Indian parts, small settlement, they're just traders. But mass immigration started in the more, you know, like 15th, 16th century onwards, I would say. So, interestingly, have you heard of the Capitan system? Okay, non-Chinese, you heard? Okay, sejarah. So, interestingly, the Capitan system is established by Portuguese, of all people. You might think, okay, British or something, but Portuguese, because they want to monitor people and they want to control the people. So, the easiest thing to do is I appoint a leader from this community, and I just talk to the leader, and the leader will control the group. Okay? So that's how the Capitan system worked, and it worked kind of so well that the British actually decided to maintain it. 19th century is actually a big time, big period in Malaya. A lot of literature has been, you know, written down about it. 18th century is when you have all the British coming in and mass immigration. And secret societies. I mean, what are the Chinese without secret societies, right? I mean, look at all the Hong Kong drama, Hong Kong movie. Sure got secret society, right? Yeah, I mean, and it has historical idea, historical notion. Because you know, the Chinese, when they come to Malaya, who are their leaders? I mean, that time, of course, you don't have Najib, you know. And you don't have Anwar and all that. So basically, they look up to the leader in their community. And because basically the British don't care about them as long as they do their job, I give you the pay, that's it, you know, it's a win-win situation. So what they do is, you know, they have these secret societies, And the leader of the secret societies is actually, in my terms, de facto politician, de facto politician. So they are like, you know, they are political leader at the time. And secret society is very influential. You have Gihin and Haishan, you have heard of it?
Yes.
Gihin and Haishan, they even caused civil war. I mean, we have heard of Malaya bloodless independent path, but actually it's not exactly true. We have civil wars actually. Selangor had a civil war between I forgot what the they are trying to fight for the throne and all that, and eventually British established. Next one. I forgot where I'm trying to go to, but yeah. Okay, just give you some data. This is Chinese in Southeast Asia. And you can see Burma is also under British. Malaya, Singapore, of course, Sarawak, Borneo. You can see actually who your colonial master is actually has an impact, you know, on your nation. Because at that time, British was also occupying some territories in the south of China, if I'm not mistaken. So it's easier, you know, they control both sides. So masuk keluar. Philippines, Indonesia, interesting. I mean, Sam, if you want to talk about that also. I think Dutch also encouraged Chinese to come. Somewhat. Next one. I think this is about, this is a racial composition. And, let's see if this is the slide, 1931. Okay, I forgot, I think this is the slide, Chinese. See next one. Okay, this is according to the states. As you can see, Chinese are more concentrated in some states than others. Next one. Okay, I'm sure I have one of the slides, but I can't remember when, but I think it's in 1931, I think. It's the year of huge political awakening for the Malays also. Because it is that time the census show for the first time in history that Malays were outnumbered in their own land. That means the Chinese and Indian, we make up together more percentage than the Malays. And that actually has a huge reaction, chain of events, chain of reaction. So the Malays, you know, started to organize themselves more because they have to stop this, you know, mass immigration at least, you know, people just coming in like that in huge numbers, next one. Okay, so we talk about the clans. Hokkien Mee, you know, Hokkien Mee Moon, Cantonese Kway Teow, Hainan Chicken Rice, you know. That, it's quite sad that the clans have been reduced to such, you know, trivial things. But it used to be way more grand than in the past, as the next slide will show. Hokkien is the number one community. We hold the biggest number. I think majority of us in Penang, you can find some in KL, Selangor, Perak some. But Perak, mostly Cantonese territory. KL also, I would say, a Cantonese territory. Johor, we have some Hokkien, quite significant, I think. Like Sini is Hokkien also. Sindhi is Hakka. Hainan!
Hainan.
You know Hainan chicken rice?
So sad that I'm reduced to a chicken rice.
So what do you know?
Huh?
You know which clan you're in?
Teochew.
Teochew or Hakka, the dialect quite kind of similar to Hokkien, right?
Hokkien and Teochew.
So I can understand some of, 80-70% of what she said, and she can understand. But if I speak Hokkien, Hindi cannot understand. So Harry and me always speak Hokkien as one of Kutuk Hindi. So basically, just show you the numbers. Hokkien, 28%. This is in the independence time, 1950. I would say the ratio is about the same right now. Because we stopped mass immigration from there. Right? So, Hakka, Cantonese, Teochew, Hainanese, Guangxi, Hokkien, Tenghua. That one I don't know.
Are you Hokkien?
Oh, you're Hokkien?
Yeah.
You want to tell what's distinctive about your clan?
Hokkien.
When people hear us speak, they don't understand. Because it's like, you know how like when you speak Cantonese, it's like, it's very easy if you know Mandarin. It's like, it's very similar. But it's like, in Hokkien, it's like very, very different.
Yeah, Cantonese and Mandarin is quite similar actually. Hokkien, actually, I think among the Chinese dialects, Hokkien is the one assimilated most with Malay. Malay words. You can find a lot of Malay words in Hokkien. And I think you can find some